love you like that. Taking care of yourself is the love no one else could ever give. Exercise and eating healthy, that's the best thing for your body. Smoking and drinking will not help. Sniffing and drugs, you'll hurt yourself. You gotta remember to check your blood pressure. You gotta take good care of yourself. Who's gonna love you like that? Taking care of yourself is the love no one else could ever give. Exercise and eating healthy, that's the best thing for your body.
Good evening, my viewing audience. In with this week's edition of Health Matters, I am your host, Chevenny Nisbet, health educator at the Health Promotion Unit. September the 20th to September the 26th is celebrated or observed as Mental Health Week. And this year, they are concentrating on Alzheimer's disease. The theme for Mental Health Week this year is Remember Me. Dementia is a syndrome characterized by disturbance of multiple brain functions, including memory, thinking, orientation, comprehension, calculation, learning capacity, language, and judgment. Consciousness is not clouded. The impairments of cognitive function are commonly accompanied and occasionally preceded by deterioration in emotional control, social behavior, or motivation. Dementia can affect a person in different ways, and progression of the disease depends upon the impact of the disease itself and the person's personality and state of health. Dementia can be divided into three stages: early stage, first year or the second year, middle stage, the second to fourth or fifth year, and the last stage, which is the late stage, the fifth year and after the fifth year. These periods are given as an approximate guideline, and not all persons with dementia will display the same symptoms. Alzheimer's disease is the most common form of dementia and possibly contributes to 60 to 70% of cases. Alzheimer's affects an individual's short-term memory. For example, a person with Alzheimer's disease may have just eaten, but tell someone that their caregiver is not giving them anything to eat. Also, that person may leave home with the intention of going to a specific place, but arrive at a different place. For an individual who has a set routine, they would go back to it even if their memory is failing. For some persons, a simple thing like going to the bathroom becomes difficult as they forget what they went to do. They may wet the bed or mess up the floor. Language skills and judgment also decline. An individual can become confused, easily irritated, and sometimes very aggressive. Some caregivers who are new to this disease oftentimes become frustrated and feel persons with the disease are just being spiteful and mischievous. For this week's edition, I have with me a special guest who's going to have a little discussion with me about Mental Health Week and Alzheimer's disease. Good morning and welcome to Health Matters.
Good morning.
Could you tell us a little about who you are?
Well, my name is Colin Tyrell.
Right.
And by profession, I'm a lawyer. Wasn't always a lawyer, but more recently, I'm a lawyer.
Okay.
Born in Nevis, grew up in Nevis, attended the Charleston Secondary School. Before that, Gingerland Chapel School, or the junior school. That's me. I live in St. John's, Hermitage.
Okay. Mm-hmm. The reason why you're here is because you have first-hand experience of Alzheimer's disease. Tell us a little about the disease.
Well, when you say first-hand experience, not because I have Alzheimer's, but
right,
because I've had to interact with someone who's very close to me who suffers from Alzheimer's, my mother. So, as I think most people who would have had any involvement with Alzheimer's would know, that it's quite challenging mentally and physically. And I think a big part of it too is not feeling competent to deal with the issue of Alzheimer's. And so that really makes the challenge a bit more difficult. You know?
Okay.
The changes that someone who you've known as well as you do, a parent, for example,
right,
the changes that they go through are difficult to deal with, difficult to understand, and, you know, but I've tried to get a better understanding by reading and studying, you know, keep myself up to date on what happens, what this disease is about, how it presents itself, etc., etc. So basically that's it.
Okay. So how was it in the early stages? Like, when, what were some of the signs that made you realize something was wrong?
I think it started with little things which you might not have put any real meaning to initially.
Right.
You know, repetition, forgetting what used to be normal, regular, easy things to remember. And then, you know, it became more pronounced, more frequent. Forgetting that you had done that. Forgetting how to do things that you might have been doing all along.
Right.
Doing things out of order, out of sequence, you know. I guess it would be unique for each person. Well, my mother, who was very organized, to see her become confused at some, you know, right, doing some simple tasks, you know, was an early indicator. You know, so, yeah, you know, things like that.
Did you assume it was Alzheimer's at first?
I can't remember, but I knew something was happening.
Off, right.
Yeah, you know. It's easy for, I guess, a layperson, especially now where there's a bit more awareness of Alzheimer's, to say it's Alzheimer's. It's just, it may not necessarily be Alzheimer's.
Right.
But nowadays, if you forget something or you repeat something, people might say that you have Alzheimer's. Which is not necessarily true. So initially, you know, I'm not competent to make a diagnosis like that.
Sure.
But you wonder, you see the change, and you may just say, well, yeah, it's old age. She's getting older or whatever. But Alzheimer's is a bit more clinical. Mm. The diagnosis of it is more clinical. You know how it is in this society, sometimes you're quick to label persons.
Right, right.
People are either crazy or they whatever,
yeah,
because they act a little differently. But, you know, that's basically it.
Okay. And what were you told about the disease and how did you feel at the time?
Initially, you know, I just accepted it as what it was, you know, it was an illness. The important thing was to try and figure out how to cope with it,
mm-hmm,
how to respond to it, how to deal with the changes that we were observing. It came on gradually. And of course, I think, which is not unique in my mother's case, I think it's common among all persons who appear to have Alzheimer's.
Mm-hmm.
They feel they are right. You know, and nobody thinks that they're ill, that they have an illness. So, whereas, for example, she may be accustomed to cooking or making tea or whatever she might be doing. And you eventually realize, you know, she's not doing this the way she normally might have done it.
Right.
And you see, you know, you pick up little indicators that something is off. And eventually, you know, it became more pronounced, and so you figure, well, something is really wrong. Until eventually you get a real diagnosis, you know, an official diagnosis.
Right.
Where you maybe pass it off to old age or whatever. But I think the important thing is to educate oneself about it.
Right.
Find out how it presents itself. What are the things to look for, how you respond to them, that kind of thing.
So you see how you were saying that sometimes they themselves don't think that something is wrong. So if, like, I guess you would have to eventually tell them that this is what's going on with you, does that frustrate the person or the, usually you would say?
Yeah, well, if I just speak about my mother, she is trained as a nurse.
Okay.
A lot of experience and training. Prior to her nursing year, she taught school here before she went away. She's qualified in England and Canada.
Okay.
And worked, you know, in big hospitals and so on. So people know her as an intelligent person.
Yes.
And she considers herself an intelligent person as well, which she is. She used to do crossword puzzles. She loves to do crossword puzzles and those kind of things. But when you realize that some of the simple tasks, which she would do without, you know, any effort, seem to be a little more challenging, then you start to take a second look. Of course, she never felt anything was wrong, you know. And I think, I mean, it's not unique to my mother.
Right.
Anybody who has the illness will probably tell you the same stories, you know. An example, she loved tea.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe she picked that up in England or wherever. But she loved to drink tea and to make tea at all hours. And I remember one time observing that she wasn't really making tea the way, she had a problem making tea. Making tea is simple.
And she'd been doing it for years.
Nothing. It's like nothing for her. But, you know, little things like that tell you that something is happening. Of course, she felt she was all right.
Mm-hmm.
And also, I think she would be... So one of the indicators was... I don't know if living in the past is really describing it correctly, but she would say... I remember one time she said she's going home to her house. And she said she's going to go home. She's leaving the house, so she's going home. Because her mother is wondering where she is. Mother must be looking for her, that kind of thing. So, you know.
Yes.
It's going back to that time and thing. But I think that illness has been around for a while. We just didn't know what it was. I remember when I was small, we heard of people walking away.
Yes.
Disappearing.
Mm-hmm.
And it makes me wonder now if that isn't what was happening all those years back. You know, people going back someplace that they might have known when they were children or whatever. And got lost. You know, so it's just a situation of the need to educate ourselves about not just Alzheimer's, but it could be any other illness. But I think the Alzheimer's one is particularly challenging, especially if it's someone who is close to you.
Right.
You know, you see those kinds of changes in behavior. So, you know, that is what I would encourage people to do, and educate your own self about the illness, because it's real and it affects people in a real way. It changes people in a way that you might not expect, you know. And things that came very easily to them, they can't do them anymore.
Wow. One of the symptoms the signs of Alzheimer's is the short-term memory. As a result, it is said that the person with condition become confused and aggressive. What, if any, precautions are put in place to avoid it?
Well, you have to ensure that person is in an environment which is safe.
Okay.
You know, don't access to sharp objects, knives, stove, matches, and stuff like that. Because, you know, like I said, they never feel that there's something wrong with them. So, yeah, she might be accustomed to cooking or baking. I like to use the example of tea because that's something she did, just like that, at any hour of the day. And they may still feel that they're competent to do those things. Whereas, you know, they really are not anymore. So you just have to ensure that they're in a safe environment. You have to monitor them all the time. Try and make the environment in which they function, they live, a little simpler, you know, and easier for them to manage, you know, and make them comfortable.
Learning that your loved ones may have any disease is difficult. How did you feel compared the initial stages to now?
If the person's close to you, you feel badly about it. You reflect on how they used to be. And you may take some people a while to come to grips with the change in behavior. So initially, you know, even though you recognize some changes in behavior, you didn't really know what it was.
Right.
We try to find, you know, try to educate ourselves as to what it could be and how do you deal with it.
And you would say that normally the person would be on, like, I guess eventually when it deteriorates.
Mm-hmm.
So they are more on the aggressive side, or they're more on the, like, sad about the fact that everybody, you know, telling them something is wrong, or?
I don't know. I think there's some stages where aggression is displayed, which comes out of frustration, I think.
Yes.
Because what would happen is you're trying to prevent them from doing something which that person feels they have always done and are still competent to do.
Yes.
And so you're telling them, well, you can't do that, don't do so and so on. especially if you're in their house with them, they might want you to leave, you know, and you can't tell them what to do in their house.
Sure.
Kind of thing. So, I think the onus is on the caregiver in a lot of instances. Well, the onus is on the caregiver to educate him or herself. Because oftentimes the person who we have diagnosed in our own wisdom is not well, doesn't feel the same way. That person thinks they know what they're doing. You know, and if the person is, you know, still physically active, it is more challenging, I use the example of my mother wanting to go home from her own house. Home, when she said that, was where she grew up, you know, where she and her siblings and her parents lived.
Years ago.
Yeah, many years ago.
Yes.
She would want to leave her house to go home. And, you know, you have to understand that. And oftentimes, if you try to prevent them from going home, it becomes difficult. So one of the things I used to do was to walk.
With her?
Walk home or towards home, and then gradually we try to encourage them to go back. You know, that kind of thing?
Yes.
Because she, you know, that thought process that I want to go home is still in her head.
Right.
You know, she going home. Especially if her mother wondering where she is. You know, but after a while she forgets that. The person might forget that, and, you know, it's easier to encourage them to just go back up here, you know. So it's just, it's like I said, it comes with practice. It comes with making the effort to understand the illness. I think the medical professionals will tell you that it's a work in progress, you know, looking after people with Alzheimer's. The reading will tell you that, you know, they're discovering new things all the time. Medication is changing, the strategies to deal with it are, you know, constantly evolving. So you have to stay on top of it, especially if the person is physically active and able. It becomes more difficult. They would fight it.
Wow.
So.
Was there support offered? And do you feel it was beneficial if there was support offered?
You know, my mother has siblings. I know one of my aunts in particular has, who is also a trained nurse, qualified nurse, and with whom she was close all the time. You know, spent a lot of time, and still does spend a lot of time with her and looking after her and so on. Relatives and friends would, you know, try and make her feel at home, so to speak, you know, comfortable. But, you know, you'd pick up the signs.
So sometimes she would have good days?
Yeah, I think most days she would have good days.
Okay.
Yeah, but there are those periods during the day when you would recognize certain things.
Yeah, so share with us some of the challenges you faced and how you got help, whether it be from caregivers or just managing the person.
Well, my mother is now at the flamboyant home.
Okay.
But prior to that, one of my aunts would kind of alternate staying with her.
Okay.
And that was particularly challenging because she would get up at odd hours, you know, not recognizing where she is, except that it's not her home.
Okay.
She wants to go home.
Yes.
No, doesn't matter the hour. So, concept of time and place and so on, difficult. So, I've had a couple of instances from my own being with her, and she would get up, get dressed, and ready to head out of the house.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, yeah. So, you know, you have to secure the premises. Because she was going home, because that is not her house. That's not where she lives. Because where she lives is where she grew up.
Right.
And, back in time, that kind of thing. And it has a tremendous effect on the caregiver as well. Because then I couldn't go in and sit in a room because I might not hear or see when she gets up to leave.
Yes.
You know? So what would happen initially was I would sleep on the couch in the living room.
Okay.
So that if she's coming out to leave, she would invariably wake me up. Or I might hear her. And she would say, well, okay, let's go home. You got to get out of here or something, you know. And then I'd be up. Or I might hear her in the kitchen trying to make tea, lighting the stove or something. So that is a kind of, you know, you have to be aware. And so you, the caregiver, also bear somebody, the toll, the physical,
yes.
You know, and mental as well, psychologically difficult. But the physical toll also is really heavy.
Share with us your greatest fear.
With respect to my mother, you know, that she might injure herself, hurt herself, you know. It's possible.
Mm-hmm.
It's possible, but I mean, yeah, you know that she wouldn't deliberately hurt herself, set out to hurt herself. I don't think she would. But if she doesn't have that awareness of what is a dangerous activity,
mm-hmm.
She could easily hurt herself. Or somebody who is afflicted with Alzheimer's could easily hurt him or herself without really intending to do it. Because then they feel that what they're doing is something that they had always been doing and that is the way they've been doing it. Which may not very well be the case. They're just confused. And they're in the process. You know, become a danger to themselves. So, the care, that is my, you know, I don't have that so much now because, I mean, she's, like I said, she's in an institution where, you know, there's
monitor.
Somebody,
yes,
people, you know, people paying attention and so on. So, but that is important. Not everybody, I don't know what the numbers are of people who are afflicted with Alzheimer's in Nevis. But I'm sure not all of them are in the home or in, you know, that kind of care. And so people who are still living at home with relatives who might not understand fully what the illness is about, it will be a challenge for them, you know. So it's I think it's a process of education that we need as well, ongoing.
Mm-hmm.
In my own way, I try to keep myself abreast of, you know, how the disease presents itself. Some of the behaviors to look for, some of the indicators, so that you know what you're responding to,
mm-hmm.
And to appreciate that you cannot deal with it by yourself, because it would be really too much, really too much.
Is it hereditary?
I don't know. I don't know.
Okay.
And I haven't been diagnosed with it.
As far as that's good.
I don't think my sister has been either.
That's good.
I don't know if my mother's sibling. I don't know that any of my mother's siblings have been diagnosed.
Okay.
So, as to where it came from,
yeah.
What caused it, the root cause of it, I can't speak to that.
Okay.
I really don't know.
Okay.
I think it you know, it's one of the. I think it's one of the. Challenges to people who work in that field because knowing what causes it, I mean, outside of the technical things that they could describe to you, what happens in the brain or whatever, whether it is something that is in process from early years and it manifests itself when you get older or whatever, I don't know. But the literature on it is always, there's a lot of it. There's a lot of research going on. Caregivers have to keep themselves abreast of you know, best practices, I guess, for dealing with people with Alzheimer's and other mental illnesses. So you know how to respond to them. You know how to identify something. I can't give a diagnosis of Alzheimer's, that somebody has Alzheimer's.
Sure.
But you might be able to pick up, you know, some odd behavior that might reflect something deeper.
Yes.
And so, you know, you have to always be alert to that type of thing. You know, it's not an easy illness to cope with.
Mm-hmm.
The changes that you see in somebody who is affected by it are so out of character that it's really difficult to accept.
Mm-hmm.
But in as much as that might be a natural initial response, you have to accept the fact that it is what it is, and learn how you respond to it in a positive way.
Okay.
That will help that person, to help yourself as well. For my own part, I've been doing a lot of reading, trying to understand it, trying to keep up with the changes in it, changes of you know, responses to the illness. Because, I mean, I'm happy that my mother still recognizes me.
That's good. That's good.
And she still recognizes, you know, relatives,
right.
Siblings and other relatives. Sometimes it appears as if she doesn't. But I know with some people, they are in that situation where they don't recognize anybody.
That's true.
And it is, you can't imagine what it would be for the person, him or herself, who can't recognize their child, doesn't know who the child is.
Yes.
And likewise, the child whose parent doesn't recognize them.
Yes, that's hard.
So it is important to educate oneself about it. There's a lot of literature on it. It's changing, the approaches to dealing with it are changing really fast. There is, you know, so there's really a real need for persons to make the effort to get a better understanding of how you deal with mental illness. Alzheimer's is just one, but there are other mental illnesses.
Sure.
Or else the toll on the caregiver will be even greater. You know, if the caregiver doesn't have a clue of what they're dealing with,
mm-hmm.
you know, it helps you a bit if you have an idea at least of what to expect. How you respond to it, to understand when you need to get some help yourself, take a break, you know what I mean? That kind of thing. So it's an ongoing process. It's an ongoing process. And I'm happy that you for this week is on, so
yes.
That, you know, some awareness can be given. People's awareness can be heightened
right.
about mental illness and Alzheimer's in particular, for me anyway. Mm-hmm. So people have a better appreciation of it. Yeah. And to understand, it's not because the people are crazy. But, you know, it's something is happening in the head which we don't understand. And I don't think somebody who 1 minute is perfectly fine will just tomorrow just is crazy. Something is happening. And we need to learn how to respond to it. What are the indicators, how you respond to those indicators, and be willing, not be afraid to seek help.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. And that has been this week's edition of Health Matters. I would like to thank Mr. Colin Tyrell for coming here with us today to give us some insight on Alzheimer's disease. The theme for this week is Remember Me. They're concentrating on Alzheimer's disease this week for Mental Health Week. The list of activities are Sunday, the 20th of September, which was yesterday. Pastors were asked to pray for persons suffering with Alzheimer's disease. Today, the 21st of September, which is dubbed Purple Day, we're wearing our purple for Alzheimer's disease. Persons are encouraged to wear something purple in acknowledgement of World Alzheimer's Day. Morning devotions on Vaughan Radio were held, and an awareness campaign is being held in the Memorial Square from 9 a.m. until. On Tuesday, the 22nd of September, is a sensitization on Let's Talk. On Thursday, the 24th of September, is the launch of Alzheimer's Association Nevis branch at 4:15 at the Alexandra Hospital Conference Room. Interested persons are asked to contact the unit. And on Friday, the 25th of September, is the first occupational therapy meeting with individuals diagnosed with Alzheimer's. This is being held at the Mental Health Unit. Thank you for viewing. The fruit of the week is mango. Mango is a good source of antioxidants that help to prevent cancer. It's good for your skin and it's also full of fiber. So have a mango or some mangoes every day this week.
Who's gonna love you like that? Taking care of yourself is a love no one else could ever give. Exercise and eating healthy, that's the best thing for your body. Smoking and drinking will not help. Sniffing and drugs, you hurt yourself. You gotta remember to check your blood pressure. You gotta take good care of yourself. Who's gonna love you like that? Taking care of yourself is a love no one else could ever give. Exercise and eating healthy, that's the best thing for your body.